Allahu, 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 Allah, Allahu, 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 Allah. We'll continue with the seerah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where we migrated to Madinah already. We covered the hijrah. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not leave of his own doing, but rather him and the Muslims with him, they left Makkah, the purest land on earth, to go to Madinah because they were forced to. And they did not leave because in Madinah they had better economic opportunities. No. In fact, they left all of their wealth, most of them. And they left their property. And they left their families, some of them. They left because of Allah. They left and they did the hijrah to go to a land where they can practice Islam. That is the only reason. On top of the other fact, like we say, as we know by now, they were being fought physically. They were being tortured, persecuted, abused, killed. Economically and other ways. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them a way out. A group had gone to Habasha, they came back, and another group went to Habasha the second time. And then they were told, all of them, now they can go to their new home, which is Madinah. And that is after the Ansar, the people from Aus and Khazraj, they had accepted Islam and they agreed in the Bay'at al-Aqaba, the Aqaba pledge. They agreed to welcome and to host and to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of this we cover. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did the hijrah, he migrated himself. He was one of the last people to do it. Whoever was left in Makkah were those who did not have the ability to go. إِلَّا الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ وَالْوِلْدَانِ. In Medina, we saw how the Prophet, we covered the hijrah and the events which happened during the hijrah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah chose for him his best companion, Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, to accompany him in the most dangerous time, to show that he's the most trustworthy person. And that is the status of Abu Bakr. That is what is reported in the Sunnah of Ibn Abi Shayba after Abu Bakr had died. That when Umar was the Khalifa, Sami'a Umar Anna Nasa Fadharahu ala Abu Bakr. That some people, they said Umar is better than Abu Bakr. Fakama yakhtub, so he stood up and he gave a sermon. He said, Wallahi, la layla. لأبي بكر أفضل من عمر وأهله. One night of Abu Bakr is better than Umar and his whole family. And then he narrated the hijrah, how Allah chose him, Abu Bakr. That shows he is better than everyone else. They reached Quba and they stayed there for how many days? Who remembers? Old people, because young people don't remember anything. The older people. How many days did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stay in Quba? And who did he stay with? He stayed in the house of the man called Kulthum ibn Hidm. And we said Kulthum is both a man and a female man. Kulthum ibn Hidm, that's where he stayed sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he stayed in Quba for 14 days. And there they prayed, if I'm not wrong, in the village of Banu Amr ibn Salim. They prayed the first Jum'ah in Islam. The first Jum'ah, Salah prayed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he left for Medina. And we saw how they welcomed him and they were waiting for him. And everybody wanted to take him to his house. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told him what? He said, a man should go to his family. And he chose to go to who? Who was his family from the tribes of Madinah? I'm just Munir. Banu Najjar. Because that was the family of his mother, Amin. And specifically from Banu Najjar, everybody was pulling the camel. The camel's name was what? What was the camel's name? Qaswa. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, "Da'uha, fa innaha ma'mur." Leave it. It knows where it's going. Allah is directing this camel. Until it stopped at the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, "Ayyu diyar ahlina aqrab?" Which house of our family is closest? And Abu Ayyub said, "Hadha daruk," this is your house. And that is the place where the camel stopped, where he sallallahu alaihi wasallam built the masjid as we know it now, the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he stayed in the house of Abu Ayyub for how long? Nobody remembers. I don't think I remember myself. He stayed in the house of Abu Ayyub for 3 weeks. For 3 weeks, until his family came. And at this time, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he only had two wives. He was only married to who and who? Huh? Who was he married to at this time?
Sauda.
Huh? No. What is correct? Khadija had died long time ago. Aisha radiallahu anha. And?
Sauda.
Now, Sauda bint Zam'ah. Sauda is the first wife the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married after Khadija. Sauda bint Zam'ah. Tayyib. And we mentioned how Abu Ayyub, he was so generous to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the first things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he did, he built the masjid. And we went through that. And we say this shows how important the masjid is in Islam. It shows you how important the masjid is in Islam. The first thing he did, he built the masjid. We talked about how Salman al-Farisi, he accepted Islam. And we talked about the Jewish man, who was a rabbi, in fact, not just any Jewish man. He came and tested the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with questions, examining him. Is he a really prophet or not? And this man ended up accepting Islam, and his name is Abdullah ibn Salam. And he said, Abdullah ibn Salam, the first words I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he came to Medina, he said, "Ayyuha an-nas, tud'imu at-ta'am, wa tusalli bil-layl wa an-nas niyam, tadkhulu al-jannata bi-salam." Rawahu Abdullah ibn Salam. He said, the first words I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "O people, give food, be generous, and stand up to pray, Zakat. Stand up to pray while people are sleeping. You'll enter Jannah with peace." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he built the masjid, and he himself participated in that and talked about that. And the second thing he did, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after building the masjid, and we showed how they became sick. Abu Bakr became sick. Bilal became sick. Almost everyone who came from Medina, from Makkah, became sick. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua that Allah takes away that humma, that fever, to a place called Juhfa. And they say, if you go there today, you'll get that fever. Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, he says that during his time. The second thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did was the mu'akha, creating the bonds of brotherhood between the Ansar the indigenous people of Madinah who welcomed the Muhajirun who came from Makkah. And remember, the Muhajirun, they were barely 100, maximum number, 100 maybe. Very few people had accepted Islam. The Ansar, there were many. As we mentioned, there was no house by this time except that everyone was Muslim except a few individuals. In Makkah, it was opposite. Islam had entered maybe every house, one individual. In Madinah, everyone was Muslim except maybe one individual. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did the mu'akhar. And we talked about that. The bonds of brotherhood. And this is something all of us we know about, but all of us we need to be reminded about how Islam, the Islamic relationship, the Islamic bond, the Islamic tie, it is deeper and greater than the ties of kinship. They became so close that one of them would offer the other his wife. Choose which wife you want, I'll divorce her. Then after the iddah, you marry her. It takes a huge level of iman for you to say that. Even just think of it. Half of my wealth is yours, take it. They came, they said, Ya Rasulullah, we have so much dead plantations, dead palm trees. Let the Muhajirun be our partners from today. They are partners. But the Muhajirun, they had that honor also. They don't want things for free. They say, Jazakumullah khair. Just teach us how to work. Because Makkah, there's no farms in Makkah. Teach us how to work in the farm, and then we share the profit. We gave the story of ar-Rahmah bin Awf. He said, the noon and the soup, just take me to the marketplace. In a few days, the Prophet saw him. He was shining. He said, Mahiya bi ar-Rahmah, what happened? Does the wife, he said, yes, I just got married. And he said, Awli manu bishad. They were so close that they thought they could inherit each other. Imagine me and you think you can inherit each other. That is the bond of Islam. And that is one thing the Prophet sallallahu walked on. Now we need to stay here for a bit. And then finally, of course, we talked about, once we discussed how the Ansar, they were so generous, we talked about the status of the Ansar. And that's where we finished off last time. If you missed any of those lectures, you have to go back and listen to them. They are available on the YouTube channel of AM. The Ansar, radiyallahu anhu, Allah gave them a position which we can never have. Why? Because they welcomed the Prophet of Islam, alayhi salatu wasalam, and they welcomed Islam and the Muslims, and no one else wanted them. When everyone else was fighting them, in fact. وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوَّأُوا الدَّارَ وَالْإِيمَانِ. We saw how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said what? لَوْ كُنْتُمْ رَيْءٍ لَكُنْتُمْ رَيْءٍ مِنَ الْأَنْصَارِ. If I was to be given a choice, Muhajir or Ansar, he said, I'll choose to be Ansar. I will choose to be Ansar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, حُبُّهُمْ إِيمَان. Loving them is part of Iman. وَبُغْضُهُمْ نِفَاق. And if you have hatred for the Ansar, you are a munafiq. How did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam get these people who are strangers? What was the teachings he was giving them such that they became so close? If you have your books, this is on page number 231. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, or some of the teachings he used to teach, like we saw Abdullah bin Salam, he says, the first thing I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was what? Ayyuhan nas tut'imu ta'am. Actually he says, Ayyuhan nas afshu salah wa tut'imu ta'am. Oh people, give the salam, whoever you meet, give him salam, assalamu alaikum. Because someone who gives you salam, number one, he loves you. Because the salamu alaikum is actual dua. May Allah grant you peace and safety and security. Number two, he shows you that there's no harm between you and him. In this hostile time, they needed that. Coming and running away from Makkah, they needed to be in a society which has peace. وَتُطْعِمُ الْدُعَامَ and give food. So many of them were poor. When you give someone something, all of us know that. The human being will gravitate towards people who give us. It's just simple. Muslim, non-Muslim, wherever you come from. Someone who gives you, you gravitate towards them, you tend to like them. It says here, with this wisdom and intellect, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam erected the pillars of the new society. This phenomenon, no doubt, left its mark on the virtuous Muslims. He used to bring them up in the light of the Islamic education, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Rabba ashab. He used to cultivate them, teach them, nurture them on the Islamic education. He sanctified their souls and enjoined them to observe righteousness and praiseworthy manners, and was keen on infusing into them the ethics of good relations, honor, nobility, worship, and first and foremost obedience to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remember, there's no zakat, there's no hajj, there's no Ramadan yet. Tawheed, included in that is believing in the akhirah, as-salah. Everything else is what we call akhlaq or mu'amalah. Don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal, don't commit zina, don't eat riba, don't cut off your families, keep good relationship, feed the poor, give salam. This was Islam. This was Islam, and that is the Islam we need to start practicing now if we want to bring a proper Islamic society. The following are some of the virtues he used to instill in the minds of the followers. A man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he came, what is the best actions in Islam? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, تُطْعِمُ الطَّعَامُ وَتُقْرِئُ السَّلَامَ عَلَى مَنْ عَرَفْتَ مَنْ لَمْ تَعَرِفْ. Give people food and give salam. Listen to this, all of you listen to this. And give salam to those Muslims you know and those you don't know. Don't just give salam to me because I'm the sheikh and this other Muslim, you don't want to know him. No. In fact, that is one of the signs of Al-Qiyamah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. In Ayat al-Sa'ah, from the signs of the last day, salam is exclusive. I know you, I give you, even if we just pray together, I don't know you, so I don't give you salam. No. So how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam build the proper society? He said, give food and give salam to those you know and those you don't know. He's Muslim, give him salam. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the things he taught around this time, he said, لَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ مَنَّا يُؤْمِنْ جَارُهُ بَوَائِقَهُ. He shall never enter Jannah, the one whose neighbor is not safe from him. Your neighbor does not feel safe from you. Your neighbor is threatened by you, whether physically or because you disturb them, or you throw your garbage in front of their door. You shall never enter Jannah. That is not Islam. Now remember, this is between the Muslims and the other people who are not Muslim yet, because in Madinah you still had what? You had the Jews, and then you had the non-Muslims, the Arabs who did not accept Islam yet. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-Muslim, the true Muslim, because this is a new religion, who are these people? Man salima al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi, is the one who other Muslims are safe and secure from his tongue and his hands. He doesn't cheat, he doesn't backbite, he doesn't curse at them, he doesn't hit them or steal from them. Your tongue and your hand, everyone is safe. That is the true Muslim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, Yes, you want to become a Muslim, you want to end it with this religion. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. You can never be a true believer unless you love for your fellow Muslim what you love for yourself. That is when they heard all of these ahadith, ikhwan. They took them right away and practiced them. They said to each other, half of my wealth is yours. These are not stories from somewhere, no. This is what happened. All of us know this is what happened. How did it happen? It happened because of this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught his sahab. He taught them. Every day they used to hear these words. And that is what we talked about today in the khutbah, khutbatul jum'ah. Salah al-mujtama, the rectification of a society, is by rectification of the individual first. If you're good, he's good, I'm good, he's good, she's good, she's good, then alhamdulillah, we have a good community, simple. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say to them, al-mu'minu ka rajulun wahid. The believers were like one man only. إِذَا اشْتَكَ عَنْهُ اشْتَكَ كُلُّهُ. If one part is sick, it's full of pain, then the whole body is full of pain. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, المؤمن للمؤمن كالبنيان يشد بعضه بعض. The believer to another believer is like one wall. You cannot build a wall where the spaces has to be held, intertwined, as they say. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, لا تباغضوا ولا تحاسدوا ولا تدابروا ولا تناجشوا ولا تجسسوا ولا تحسسوا وكونوا عباد الله إخوانا. المسلم أخو المسلم لا يظلمه ولا يحقره ولا يسلمه ولا يخذله بحسب امرئ من الشر أن يحضر أخاه المسلم. الله أكبر. يسأل صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تباغضوا, don't hate each other. ولا تدابروا, don't turn away from each other. I see if it's coming from this note, so I'm going to go through this note. ولا تحاسدوا, don't have hasad, envying each other. ولا تناجشوا, a najsh is when you buy something. I want to sell him this book, I say okay. He says I'll give you $20, I say okay. You come, he says I'll give you $30. That's wrong. That's Islam. ولا تجسسوا, don't spy on each other. ولا تحسسوا. The difference between تجسس and تحسس, تجسس is when you hide, you're a spy, you're undercover, you're hidden. And تحسس when you do it openly. The Muslim doesn't do that. وكونوا عباد الله إخوانا. Be Muslims for the sake of Allah. المسلم أخو المسلم. The Muslim is a brother of another Muslim. لا يظلمه, he does not oppress him. Either by your tongue or by your hand. ولا يحقره, he doesn't look down on him. ولا يسلمه, he doesn't give him up to the عدو, to the enemy of Islam. ولا يخذله, he doesn't break his hopes. If a Muslim has hopes in you, you'll help him, you'll take care of him. Don't let him down. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished off this great hadith by saying, بِحَسْبِ مْرِئٍ مِنَ الشَّرْءِ. It is enough evil and تَحْضِرَ أَخَاقَ الْمُسْلِمِ, that you look down on your fellow Muslim brother. That is it, meaning if you didn't do any sin except this one, it's enough to destroy you. That you look down on another Muslim and you feel you're better than them. These are some of the hadith, ikhwan, other than the ayat of the Quran, which the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were being cultivated on, tarbiyah. That is why when we hear these people are ready to inherit each other, and they only know each other for less than 3, 4, 5 months, it is because of this kind of tarbiyah. Al-Islam, and this, you know, this is something which amazes those who don't know Islam. They're not Muslims. Those who don't know about Islam, they always wonder why Muslims are killed in Afghanistan in the end of the world. Muslims in Canada, they protest. They don't understand, some of them. Like, what's your business? No. Those are my brothers. أخوة الإيمان. But we need to be really brothers. Cannot be superficial. Cannot be superficial. It is sad. We pray with each other. 4 years now, same masjid. Every Isha we meet in the masjid. I still don't know your name. Let alone knowing your problem so I can help you. Because that's what we're going to know tomorrow now. This brotherhood we have learned. What is the rights of each other? Is it just brotherhood, a hadith we mentioned in khalas, everybody goes home? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we need the mu'akha, the brotherhood between the Muslims, between the muhajirun and the ansar, and sometimes between the muhajirun also. From the rights of a Muslim towards another Muslim. Number one, at-tanasuh. Wal-amru bil-ma'roof wal-nahy anil munkar. It is to give each other nasiha, sincere advice, and to command each other to do what is good and to forbid what is evil. That is part of the brotherhood we have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqul, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضُ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And the believers, males and the female believers, they are awliya, allies of each other. But it doesn't stop there. What do they do now, practically? They command each other to what is good. If you see my son, you know the iqamah has been called, and my son is still playing with water in the wudu area, you need to tell my son, Habibi, Allah, salah, salah. Don't act like he doesn't exist. يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You see someone is coming and blocking everyone in the parking lot, creating chaos. It is your duty. Don't say, oh, I don't walk in this masjid. I just pray here. No. Al-amru bil ma'roof wajib min wajibat al-Islam. It's a must. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he warned, لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You will command good and you will forbid evil all. I fear that Allah will punish all of you. ثُمَّ تَدْعُونَ اللَّهُ وَلَا يَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Then you'll make dua and Allah will never accept your dua. Yes. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the best example. The mathal, the example of those who command good and those who don't command good and forbid evil. He said it's like the example of people who are in one ship which is flowing on the river. فَاسْتَهَمُوا, so they did the Qur'an, they drew lots, and some of them they were on the upper deck and some of them were on the lower deck of the ship. But those on the lower deck, when they wanted water, they had to go up every time to get water. Until they said to each other, why do we bother our brothers who are up there every time? If you only dig a hole in the ship, we can get the water directly. That's not a good idea, right? Because if you do that, all of you are going to sink and drown dead. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those are on the top. Either they stop them and they're all saved, or they let them and they all drown. And that is the example of those who command good and those who don't command. So from the rights of the believer to each other is at-tanasuh, ad-deenu nasiha. And of course, at-tanasuh and amr ma'roof and nahy al-munkar, it is done with hikmah, al-mu'idah al-hasanah, with wisdom and good words. Number two, from the rights of a Muslim to another Muslim, hajat. It is to help each other physically. Someone has a need, they want to achieve, you help them physically. We talked about this today in the khutbah. Allah subhanahu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? وَاللَّهُ بِعَوْنِ الْعَبْدِ مَا كَانَ الْعَبْدُ فِي عَوْنِ أَخِيهِ. Allah will continue to help you as long as you are helping your fellow Muslim. There is a simple principle of life. If you see that Allah is not taking care of you, you always have problems in your life. Ask yourself, when's the last time I helped someone? When's the last time I helped someone just to carry his groceries? What nusra, and to help them when they need the help. And if you can't help them physically, you make dua for them. Number three. Ad-du'a bi dhuhr al-ghayb, which we just touched on, is to make dua for them when they are not around you. Bi dhuhr al-ghayb. And we learned this last time, because Allah, when He described the Muhajirun and the Ansar, then He described those who come after them. What do they do? وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِ الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَ بِالْإِيمَانِ. And those who came after the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, they always love the Sahaba and they make dua for them. And that's for every Muslim, make dua for him. If he needs help, make dua for him. If you feel that Muslim is deviated, he's mubtadi', he's lost, make dua for him, Allah returns him to the truth. The Muslim always has a clean heart. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ فِي قُلُوبِنَا غِلًّا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Oh Allah, don't make in our hearts hatred against other believers. It's from the حقوق الأخوة, from the rights of brother. Number three, to make dua. Number four is part of that, to make dua for them whether they're alive or they're dead. So number four, الإصلاح بينهم إذا وقع بينهم خلاف ونزاع. It is for you to reconcile between believers when they fight with these problems between them. إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا. Surely the believers are brothers. So make peace, reconcile between them. This action is so great in Islam, al-Islah, that you're allowed to lie, to tell lies just to reconcile between people. That's how great it is. One of the few situations you're allowed to lie. Let's say me and Qudayfa were fighting. So you come and you say to Qudayfa, you know, Abu Umar is very stressed. He wishes that never happened. He would love to become friends with you again. In fact, he misses you. I was there yesterday drinking tea with him. And yesterday you were in Montreal, you're not even with him. Then you come to me and you said, oh, Qudayfa, he was crying yesterday for you. To create Islam, it is allowed to lie, imagine. Allahu Akbar. لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا أو إصلاح الله. Every other talk we do, there's no benefit in it. So number four is إصلاح. Number five. It is for you to practically love him the way you love yourself. And this is difficult. This is very difficult. We love ourselves more than our own children sometimes. The wife's not even mentioned that yet. And she loves herself more than she loves you a million times. Lakin, that is what Islam. Especially those who are close to you, your children, your wife, your father, your mother, and they are Muslim, they have double rights of you. You love them because of sila, the relationship, and you love them because they are Muslim. Why do you think the Prophet ﷺ said the best sadaqah is the one you give to your own relative, your brother, your sister, your mother, your wife? Because it serves two purposes: Islam and relationship. Number six, at-ta'awun ala al-birr wa taqwa. It is to cooperate upon what is good and righteous. Any Muslim who's doing something which is good and righteous and he needs your help, you have to cooperate with them. You have to. In fact, this transgresses even Muslims, non-Muslims. If they're doing something which is good, there's nothing wrong with cooperating with them. In fact, you should. Number seven. It is to visit each other. Yes, we love each other, mashallah. Why don't we visit each other? And visits don't have to be for food. You know, because some of us, we know how to give excuses. Oh, my wife, she can't cook. It doesn't have to be for food. But you visit each other to renew that love between you. Khwani, we're discussing again the practical ways of this love the Prophet ﷺ came to teach us, what Islam teaches us. The Prophet ﷺ said, قال الله تعالى, and had this hadith Qudsi, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي, Allah Akbar, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَزَاوِرِينَ فِيَّ. Allah says, my love has become obligated on the people who love each other for me because of Islam, that's all. And they visit each other for me. I'm just visiting you because you're a fellow Muslim. And they sit to each other with each other for me. Not because there's a business deal, not because it's from my tribe, no. And I'm sure all of us know the famous hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "What? Inna rajulan zara akhan lahu fi qaryatin ukhra." There's a man, he sent out to walk, and he was walking to the next village to visit his Muslim brother. فَأَرْسَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى مَدْرَجَتِهِ مَلَكًا. Allah sent an angel in the form of human being after him, walking behind him, until he met him. And he said to him, "Ya Abdullah, أَيْنَ تُرِيدُ, where are you going?" فَقَالَ أُرِيدُ أَخًا لِي فِي هَذِهِ الْقَرْيَةِ, I'm going to visit a Muslim brother of mine in this village. And the angel in the form of a human being said to him, هَلْ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُرُبُّهَا, is there something you want from him? There's a favor he's going to do for you? قَالَ لَا, he said, no, except that I love him for the sake of Allah. And the angel said to him, فَاشْهَدْ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَحَبَّكَ بِحُبِّكَ إِيَّاهُ أَوْ بِزِيَارَتِكَ إِيَّاهُ. I'm a messenger from Allah telling you that Allah loves you because you are visiting Him. This is Sahih al-Bukhari, it's not stories from Alf Layla wa Layla. Visiting each other. Number eight. And when I read this yesterday or today, I said I had to share it with you. ومن أعظم حقوق الأخوة في الله أن لا يكون الأخ أحق بدرهم. The dollar you have in your pocket, there should be no preference, me and you. It's yours in your pocket. It's in your wallet, the credit, the Visa or MasterCard you have. I should have enough rights to go into your pocket because we are brothers. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "What? ليس المؤمن الذي يشبع وجاره جائع إلى جنبه." It's not the believer. He's full, mashallah, doing well, and your neighbor is hungry, struggling in life. ولقد أتى أبا هريرة رجل فقال يا أبا هريرة, a man came to Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه and said to him, يا أبا هريرة, إن يريد أن أخيك في الله, I want to become your brother in Islam because of Allah. فقال أبو هريرة, أبو هريرة said to him, وَهَلْ تَدْرِ مَا حَقُّ الْأُخُوَةِ Do you know what is the right of brotherhood in Islam? قَالَ لَا أَدْرِ He said, I don't know. فَقَالَ أَبُو هُرَيْرَ أَبُو هُرَيْرَ said, إِنَّ مِنْ حَقِّ الْأُخُوَةِ أَلَّا تَكُونَ حَقَّ بِدِرْهَمِكْ وَلَا دِينَارَكْ مِنِّي The dollar you have, the gold and the silver you have, which is yours, should not be more yours than mine. You should be equal in it. فَقَالَ الرَّجُلُ the man, he said, لَمْ أَبْلُغُ هَذِهِ الْمَنْزِلَةِ I have not yet reached this status. فَقَالَ أَبُو هُرَيْرَ فَإِلَيْكَ عَنْدِي Abu Huraira said then, stay on the side. We cannot be brothers yet. And a man came to Abu Ja'far. Wasur Abu Ja'far. Abu Ja'far is al-Baqir. Muhammad al-Baqir. Right? La, Abu Ja'far. Abu Ja'far is Muhammad al-Baqir. And those are our imams, brother. Some of you are looking at me funny already. Abu Ja'far, Muhammad al-Ja'far al-Salim. Those imams, the Shia al-Ashariya, Rafida, they claim those are imams of Ahl al-Sunnah. 101%. None of them was Shia. None of them. Not even one. Not even 0%. Purely Ahl al-Sunnah. From the best people in Islam. But the Rafida, they're the best liar. قال أبو جعفر لأصحابه يوما One day he said to his companions أيدخل أحدكم يده في جيب أخيه فيأخذ من ماله ما يريد Can one of you enter his hand into the pocket of his friend and take whatever he wants? قالوا لا They said no فقال فلستم إخوان كما تزعمون He said that you are not brothers like you claim Allahu Akbar We claim we follow the Salaf. These are the Salaf. The Salaf is a shi'ar, it's not just a claim. I'm following the Salaf. No. Be like them. This is ukhuwah, ikhwan. This is ukhuwah, true brother. Okay, don't go into my pocket today. We're not there yet. But what we can start with is what? If someone from among us comes and says, I have a problem, we should have no problem giving him right away. Right away. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when someone came and asked, they did not question him. As long as he's known, he's not a liar, they gave him right away. Especially if you say, help me for the sake of Allah. Abdullah bin Umar, he used to have his slave. Every time you come and say, Ya Abdullah bin Umar, help me for the sake of Allah, and you give him. And they will tell him, his son, Salim will tell him, you know he's lying to you. And Abdullah will say, Man khada'ana fi Allah, whoever betrays us for Allah, then we'll get betrayed. It's okay. One day I was in a certain masjid in Toronto, and there's a man who stood up after Salatul Dhuhr, and he said, Ya Ikhwan, I have problems. And I've tried to seek assistance from the government and this and that, they can't help me. I need you to help me. And of course, the management of the masjid stood up and said, well, stop talking, go outside. So I had to sit with that management and have a long meeting and say, if they can't come to the masjid and seek for help, where should they go? To the church? Because it's easy, especially when someone has weak iman, to go and do that. And it go once, it go twice, it go thrice, tomorrow is going to go to church. That is happening, what is happening to Muslims in Africa. Am I right or wrong, Shaykh? Simple, food only, makes people change their deen. The masjid is not just for us to pray. If a fellow Muslim cannot come and ask for his problems in the masjid, then we have not yet reached there. That is just reality. We like it, we don't like it. Number 10. Is it 9 or 10? Oh, we'll stop there. I wanted to spend time on this because it's very important. Like we said in the beginning, our promise was what? We are going to learn the seerah and learn the practical seerah. not just stories we're going to read.
No.
If because we don't learn from the seerah what we need to be, then there's no point. I'm saying this personally. I will not teach the seerah because it's a story we're reading. You can read yourself. Al-Ukhuwa. It's very important. All of us know this hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, we didn't see Fulan today. Where is he? He didn't come to pray. This is ukhuwa fil Islam. So this is the second thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. He built his brother practical. Number three, from the things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in Madinah, after establishing the Masjid and creating the Brotherhood, he signed or he wrote a couple of charters or treaties or peace covenants, agreements. And there's three of them. One agreement, one covenant is between the Muslims themselves. And one was between the Muslims and the other forces which are in Medina. So one was between him, the Muslims, sorry, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the Jews. Because they are the most powerful people in Medina, even though they live outside of Medina. And then one he signed between the Muslims and the Mushrikul Arab. The Arabs were still not Muslim. So he covered everybody. So if you're reading a book, this is page number, page is this? 229 at the bottom there. A chart of Islamic alliance. So just as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he established a code of brotherhood among the believers, so too he was keen on establishing friendly relations between the Muslim and non-Muslims, tribes of Arabia. He established a treaty aiming at ruling out all pre-Islamic enmities and inter-tribal hostilities. All of us know again, the people of Medina, they used to fight a lot, the Aus and the Khazraj. And Allah finally joined them by Islam. But still, some of that hatred remained. And still, some of them were not Muslims. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was so careful not to leave any area in the charter that would allow pre-Islamic traditions to creep in or violate the new environment he wanted to establish. And this shows you the diplomatic side of Islam and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So yes, you have to be built. Your iman has to be built. This is the brotherhood. But then there's the diplomacy and the politics with those who are not Muslims. So one of them he wrote to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a document from Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, regarding the muhajirun, the immigrants and the helpers, the answar. This is the document for the Muslims between themselves and those who follow the strong with them. Number one, the Muslims, they are one nation, one ummah, to the exclusion of other people. You are one ummah. Number two, the muhajirun of the Quraysh, they shall unite together and pay blood money from among themselves, meaning if one of them was to commit murder, then all of them have to come together to pay the blood money for him. And they shall ransom honorably their prisoners. If one of them was to be taken as a prisoner, all of them shall unite to pay for him. Every tribe of the Ansar now, they shall unite together as they were before Islam. And every section among them will pay a ransom for releasing his relative prisoners. Number three, the believers shall not leave anyone poor among them by not paying his redemption money or blood money in kind. Meaning any Muslim Now, if a man, let's say he committed murder, or he was taken as a captive, and he's poor, then we as Muslims, all of us have to come together to pay for him. Regardless of his tribe, his qabila, where he comes from, color of his skin, his passport, it doesn't matter. We are Muslims. Number four, whoever is rebellious, or whoever asks, or sorry, whoever seeks to spread enmity and sedition between the Muslims, the hand of every God-fearing Muslim shall be against him, even if he be his own son. Whoever tries to cause problems between the Muslims, then all of us should stand up against him, even if that is your own child. Number five, a believer shall not kill another believer, nor shall he support a disbeliever against a believer. If you pay attention to these points, they are focused on these issues. Why? Because we talked about the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ was teaching them on what? Feed the poor, give the salah, take care of each other, you know? What about the jinayat, the capital issue? This is what it was settled. Number six, the protection of Allah is one and is equally extended to the humblest of the believers, dhimma. The dhimma of a Muslim, it extends every Muslim, even the poorest. What does this mean? It means, if I as a Muslim give protection to a non-Muslim, a kafir, I say, I give you my protection, then all of us have to respect that, even if I am the weakest and the poorest of the Muslims. The dhimma of a Muslim, it encompasses everybody. And this, we're going to see it during the Fath of Makkah, when the Prophet ﷺ went to open Makkah after years. And Ali ibn Abi Talib wanted to kill a certain man who was a mushrik, an enemy of Islam. And his sister, what's the name of the sister of Ali? Now, Hani, Akhwani, I'm sorry to say this, I said this here before. The Ahlul Bayt, they are our people. It is a shame that we don't know about the Ahlul Bayt in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah, it's a shame, aib, that we don't know them. Because they deserve a special respect. They are the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Muslims among them. The sister of Ali ibn Abi Talib is Hani. And when the Prophet ﷺ went to Makkah, during Fath Makkah, he stayed in her house. So Ali wanted to go kill this man who was an Muslim. And Hani, she came running to the Prophet ﷺ. And she said, I give protection to this man. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, what? The dhimma of a Muslim covers everyone. Oh, Ali, leave him. Number six, sorry, that's number six. Number seven, the believers, they support each other. Number eight, whosoever of the Jews, they follow us, they shall have the help and the aid, and they shall not be injured, nor an enemy should be aided against them. When someone becomes Muslim, they're Muslim. That's it. Don't say, oh, you know, you used to be this. No. Number nine, the peace of the believers is indivisible. No separate peace shall be made when believers are fighting in the way of Allah. Conditions must be fair and equitable to all. Number 10, it shall not be lawful for a believer who holds my watches in this document and believes in Allah in the last day to help a criminal nor give him refuge. Those who give him refuge and provide him help shall have the curse, the la'na, and the end of Allah on the day of resurrection. Their indemnity is not accepted. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man awa muhdithan," whoever gives refuge and protection to someone who does what? Someone who creates problems, someone who's a criminal, then عَلَيْهِ لَعَنَةُ اللَّهِ, Allah curses you because you give protection to that criminal. Can you imagine? Number 11, killing a believer deliberately with no good reason and chance killing the killer unless the heirs consider it otherwise. And that is the hukm in Islam. If someone murders another person for no reason, then his punishment, he should be murdered also. He should be killed. Unless the heirs, the inheritors, the family of the victim, they forgive. And these are issues that are discussed in fiqh. This is a chapter in fiqh. Every fiqh you study, whatever you call yourself, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali, whatever you call yourself, there has to be a chapter on this. And by the way, all of the family has to accept. If someone killed one, let's say my brother, and I have five brothers, all of us have to say, yes, he should be killed. Especially if he says, yes, I'm guilty, I killed him. But if one of us, of the four brothers remaining, say, no, he should not be killed, he's not killed, Islam. Islam came to preserve life. Then we say, he pays the blood money. And if you say, we don't want your blood money, then he's free to go. فَمَنْ عُفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ شَيْءٌ فَاتِّبَاعُ مِنْ مَعْرُوفٍ. Number 12. Whenever, listen to the last part, whenever you differ about anything, it must be referred to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, after salat. وَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. If you differ about anything, return it to Allah. If only we did this, Muslims of today, we wouldn't have so much problems. If you stop saying, my Sheikh, no, stop. Your Sheikh, leave him alone for now. What did Allah say in His book? What is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? خلاص. فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If you're true believers. So this is the charter the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he wrote for the Muslims between themselves. And then he wrote another charter between the Muslims and the Jews of Medina. So it says here, this is page number 237. Soon after emerging to Medina, or emigrating to Medina, sorry, and making sure the pillars of the new Islamic community were well established on strong base of administrative, political, and ideological unity, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to establish regular and clearly defined relations with non-Muslims now. We fix within ourselves first, and then we fix what is outside. There's so many Islamic groups today, they do this mistake over and over and over and over again. They want to fix outside before the Muslims themselves, they're rotting, inside, rotting. You can't. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said, لَنْ يُصْلِحْ هَذِ الْأُمَّةِ وَأَخْرِ هَذِ الْأُمَّةِ إِلَّا بِمَا صُلَحَ أَوَّلُ. You can never rectify this ummah except with what rectified the first part of this ummah. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that, that is the manhaj before. So, all of these efforts were exerted solely to provide peace, security, and prosperity to all mankind at large, and to bring about the spirit of understanding and harmony within his religion in particular. These were people 13 years, they have been tortured, persecuted in Makkah. Some of them were killed. They had to run to Medina. The one thing they need is what? Peace, security. Any human being will tell you that. The one thing you need is peace and security, even if you're so poor. You'll trade wealth to peace and security. Because if you're a millionaire, yet you cannot even step out of your house, what good is that million? Al-Amn, having peace and security, is one of the great favors of Allah. That is where Allah imtanna ala Quraysh Makkah. فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتَ الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُ مِنْ جُوعٍ وَآمَنَهُ مِنْ خَوْفٍ. We live in a peaceful land. We should thank Allah a million times every day, wallah. Most of us, you can leave your door and not lock it. And no one is going to come touch your door. You can walk to the masjid. Nobody is going to say anything to you. Yet we seem to forget that. From the countries we come from, some of us, people cannot do that today. There's no amr. This is a great ni'am of Allah, and we're going to see that. Why is the Prophet signing this treaty? He's creating peace and security. And now the Muslim numbers will double, triple. They will go skyrocket, as they say. From a few hundred Muslims, they'll become hundreds of thousands soon. Because Islam, it grows in peace and security. It's simple. So, geographically, the closest people to Medina were the Jews. While harboring evil intentions and nursing a bitter feeling of resentment, they showed neither the least resistance nor the slight hostility. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided to conclude a treaty with them, with clauses that provided full freedom in faith and wealth. He had no intention whatsoever of following severe policies involving expulsion or seizure of wealth and land or hostility. The treaty came within the context of a larger framework relating to inter-Muslim or inter-religion relationship. The most important provisions of the treaty are the following. Number one, the Jews of Banu Awf, and that is what they were called. The Jews of Medina, they were called the Jews Yahud Banu Awf. They are one community with the believers. The Jews will profess their religion and the Muslims will profess their religion. The Prophet ﷺ will say to them, we are living in one country, one city. We are one people. You have your religion and we have your religion, yes. But at the end of the day, we are living together. Number two. The Jews shall be responsible for their expenditure and the Muslims for theirs. Economically, you are free and we are free. Number three, if attacked by a foreign party, someone attacks you or us, each shall come to the help of the other. If someone attacked the Jews, we Muslims are going to help you. If someone attacked us, you are going to help us. Number four, each party shall hold counsel with the other. Mutual relations shall be founded on righteousness. Sin is totally excluded. We shall come together. And whatever is good, we shall do it together. Whatever sinful, we're not going to do. Number five. Neither shall commit sins to the prejudice of the other. Number six, the wrong party, al-madlum, he shall be aided, whether you're Yahudi or you're Muslim. If you're oppressed, all of us are going to help you. Number seven, the Jews shall contribute to the cost of war, so long as they're fighting along the believers. If you're fighting together, then you have to contribute to the military expenses. Number eight, Medina shall remain haram, sacred and inviolable, for all that join this treaty. Anyone who signs this treaty should know Medina is haram. Number nine, should any disagreement arise between the signatories to this treaty, then Allah the All High and His Messenger shall settle the dispute. Look at that. The Prophet ﷺ is saying to them, if we differ, we're not going to judge by the Torah, we shall judge it by the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number 10, the signatories to this treaty shall boycott the Quraysh commercially, and they shall also abstain from extending any support to them. Remember, the Quraysh, they are the number one enemies, criminals, terrorists, tyrants, rip-offs. They killed so many Muslims and chased them from the land and took their property. So the Prophet ﷺ is siding with the Jews. We cannot help the Quraysh. And commercially, you cannot do business with them. Number 11. Each shall contribute to defending Medina in case of a foreign attack in its respective area. If they attack from your areas, you Jews, you shall defend Medina and we'll come and help you. If they attack from our areas, we shall defend Medina, then you come and help us. And number 12, this treaty shall not hinder either party from seeking lawful revenge. Meaning if someone is oppressed, revenge is permissible. This is the treaty the Prophet ﷺ signed with the Jews. And then he signed another treaty with the Mushrikul Arab, the Arabs of Medina who had not become Muslims. And that one was short. Basically it said, you shall not have the Quraysh. Because those are the enemies. And anyone who supports them, then this treaty is done, is cancelled. And you have the right to worship in your religion, and we are going to worship as Muslims. This is what is called today, interfaith relations or interfaith dialogue. The Muslim should not say that when you go to that interfaith dialogue, oh, we are all one religion, we worship the same God. A'udhu billah, kufr. That is kufr. No, we don't worship the same God. Inna ad-deena 'inda Allahi al-Islam. Wa man yabtaghi ghayra al-Islam deenan falan yuqbala minhu. But we can co-live and coexist and share our societal problems and tackle them together, yes. Interfaith cooperation. That's what the Prophet ﷺ is doing. And he was very clear about it. So this shows you, the Prophet ﷺ is the greatest man alive. The greatest politician. The greatest diplomat. The greatest leader ever to live. With this, those are the three things the Prophet ﷺ he sent for the society of Medina. The Masjid, the Brotherhood, and then the peace conference or treaties with the non-Muslims. Now he had secured Medina from inside. But the threats from outside, as we're going to see tomorrow, they were still very much active. Okay, we'll stop here. We'll continue tomorrow, inshallah, at 3 p.m. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك جزاكم الله خيرا وبارك الله فيكم